Hi, let's talk about the subclavian, axillary, and brachial arteries and some of their branches. In this video, we'll discuss the major branches of the subclavian, axillary, and brachial arteries. Let's start with the subclavian artery. The subclavian artery on the right side originates in the brachiocephalic trunk. On the left side, it's typically a direct branch of the arch of the aorta. We could divide the subclavian artery into three parts. The first part is medial to the medial edge of the anterior scalene muscle. The second part is deep to the anterior scalene muscle. And the third part is lateral to the lateral edge of the anterior scalene muscle out to the border of the first rib. The branches of the subclavian artery are going to provide blood to a variety of important areas. So with respect to the first part of the subclavian artery, we have the vertebral artery that ascends through the transverse foramina of cervical vertebrae 6 through 1 and then enters the cranium through the foramen magnum. The vertebral artery is therefore going to supply the brain and the cranial meninges with blood, as well as the spine through the spinal arteries and the spinal meninges with blood. We also have the internal thoracic artery, which descends through the anterior wall of the thorax, supplying the thoracic and abdominal walls with blood. And then finally, we have this thyrocervical trunk arising from the first part, which has four major branches. There is the inferior thyroid artery. The inferior thyroid artery supplies the thyroid gland as well as the parathyroid glands with blood, and also the larynx with blood. Then there is the ascending cervical artery. The ascending cervical artery supplies some of the deep neck muscles, in particular the scalene group, with blood. We also have a transverse cervical artery. That transverse cervical artery is supplying the trapezius muscle with blood. Sometimes that transverse cervical artery can host a third artery, the dorsal scapular artery, that we'll get to when we discuss the third part of the subclavian artery. And then finally, last but definitely not least, we have the suprascapular artery. The suprascapular artery is going to supply some of the rotator cuff muscles, in particular the supraspinatus and infraspinatus, with blood. Behind anterior scalene, we have the second part that has but one branch, which is the costo-rib cervical trunk. The costocervical trunk has a branch serving deep neck muscles, as well as a branch called the superior intercostal artery, serving the first two intercostal spaces with blood. And then finally, the third part has one branch, and that is the dorsal scapular artery. The dorsal scapular artery serves the muscles along the medial border of the scapula with blood, so in particular, levator scapulae and the rhomboid muscles, major and minor, with blood. And as I've said before, sometimes this can be a branch of the transverse cervical artery. Now, as we move beyond that lateral border of rib 1, we enter into the axillary artery. The axillary artery traverses the axilla, or the armpit region, and it's going to be an important supplier of blood to surrounding structures, but it's also going to be important for the brachial plexus because portions of the brachial plexus, you know, divisions and cords, are going to be named for their relative locations to that axillary artery. Here we've removed the axillary vein and its tributaries as well as the brachial plexus so that we can focus on the artery. So like the subclavian artery, the axillary artery also has three divisions or parts. These are all named in reference to another muscle, and that other muscle is the pectoralis minor muscle. So Everything medial to pectoralis minor is the first part. Anything behind pec minor is the second part. And anything lateral to pec minor is the third part. That first part of the axillary artery has one branch called the superior thoracic artery, which we can see here. Superior thoracic supplies serratus anterior. You can see some of the slips of serratus anterior with blood, as well as the first two intercostal spaces with blood. Then we move into the second part of the axillary artery, and there are two major branches here. The first that I'll point out is going to be the thoracoacromial artery. Thoracoacromial artery is going to supply pectoralis major and minor with blood, as we can see branches to that there, as well as branches to the deltoid muscle and the shoulder with blood. So that's the thoracothorax acromial, like the acromion process, artery. The other branch is the lateral thoracic artery, and the lateral thoracic artery is going to be the dominant blood supply to serratus anterior. So serratus anterior also got a little help from the superior thoracic artery there. Next up, the third part of the subclavian artery has three major branches. First, let's look at this one. This is the subscapular artery. Subscapular artery can supply the infraspinatus, the teres muscles, major and minor, and the subscapularis muscle with blood. But it has two important branches. One branch that we could see descending here is the thoracodorsal artery. Thoracodorsal artery is the main blood supply to latissimus dorsi, which we can see there. And then the other is the circumflex scapular artery. The circumflex scapular artery wraps around the scapula, supplying the infraspinatus as well as the teres muscles with blood, major and minor, and we can see teres major right there. That circumflex scapular artery is one of three arteries that have extensive anastomoses about the shoulder. So the other two are the suprascapular, if you recall that from the thyrocervical trunk, and the dorsal scapular artery, which is from the third part of the subclavian artery. The remaining two branches of the third part of the axillary artery are the anterior circumflex humeral and the posterior circumflex humeral. And we can see that posterior circumflex humeral diving deep through there. That's oftentimes accompanied by the axillary nerve of the brachial plexus. And these two circumflex humeral arteries are going to supply collateral circulation to the deltoid muscle, as well as the proximal muscles of the brachium or the arm. Generally, posterior is a little more robust than anterior. At the inferior margin of teres major, the axillary artery becomes the brachial artery. And here we can see the continuity of the brachial artery descending down the anterior compartment of the arm. And we can also see the deep brachial artery, which we'll discuss next, going to the posterior compartment of the arm. So the brachial artery is going to run down the anterior aspect of the arm here. And it, as you've seen, gives off the posterior or the deep brachial artery, supplying the posterior compartment of the arm. That brachial artery in the vicinity of the cubital fossa is going to divide into the ulnar artery and the radial artery. The radial artery is going to be found along the lateral border of the forearm, the ulnar around the medial border of the forearm. And that radial artery is going to be an important pulse palpation point. Now, if we're rotating the hand around in the distal forearm here, so now we have lateral on this side and medial on this side. The radial artery, as it traverses the carpal region is going to give rise to the deep palmar arch. The deep palmar arch is going to be deep through here. The ulnar artery gives rise to the superficial, here's the ulnar artery, palmar arch. And I always remember ulnar is the superficial palmar arch because superficial has a U from ulnar in it. Now these two palmar arches typically anastomose, which means that the radial and the ulnar arteries also typically anastomose, which is handy to know because that allows us, if there is strong collateral flow to the hand there, to either cannulate and or harvest the radial artery if circumstances should require. And that leads us to the assessment question for this video. That is, if present, an anastomosis with which artery allows for safe cannulation of the radial artery? To cannulate is to insert a needle or a cannula, a hollow device, into an artery. So which one of these arteries can provide good collateral circulation that would allow us to cannulate the radial artery to temporarily occlude its blood flow? Would it be axillary? Nope, that's up in the axilla. Brachial? Nope, that's in the arm. Deep brachial? Nope, that's in the arm again. Subclavian? Whoa, that's way far away from this. Ulnar? Yep, absolutely. Radial and ulnar both supply the antebrachium or the forearm with blood, and both are going to generally anastomose through their deep and superficial palmar arches. Deep through the radial artery, superficial through the ulnar artery. Therefore, E, ulnar, is the artery that, if it has an anastomosis, will allow for the cannulation of the radial artery. Thank you very much for your time.